Hello everybody, my name is Rachel and welcome to my channel Colonati. Today I'm doing my last batch of books for the A to Z readathon. I'm going to wrap up R through Z with the exceptions of X and Y, which I did not manage to read books for in May. So let's start off with R, Romancing the Inventor by Gail Carriger. This is a novella, the first in the Supernatural Society series. Over the past couple of years, Carriger has started self-publishing some of her works, and I have really enjoyed the ones I've read so far. Romancing the Inventor and this series, with more projected to come, are part of the Paracel Protectorate and Custard Protocol series, and people like Alexia do appear occasionally. Romancing the Inventor is a lesbian romance tale about Imogen, a parlor maid at the Woolsey Hive, who meets Genevieve LeFou, the cross-dressing inventor lady, who I don't remember enough of from the Paracel Protectorate books. I don't recall her being my favorite character, but this is post all of that, after those events and her actions, and I thought this ended up being pretty sweet romance between the two of them. This was not exactly my cup of tea, most certainly because I do not read a lot of straight up romance. This is really heavy on that and the physical sexual elements of it, and that just doesn't do much for me, but I did enjoy it. I liked being back in the world. I like seeing Genevieve LeFou again, and I think the next novella in this series is going to feature Biffy and Lyle, and that's the one that I really, really want. So as an appetizer before that, it was quite good. For S, I read Solaris by Stanislaw Lem. I had originally said that this was translated from Polish into English, and that is not exactly correct. This book was originally written in Polish, translated into French, and then translated from French into English. And the translators from the French are Joanna, Kilmartin, and Steve Cox. So Solaris is a pretty well-known book. It's quite famous because it's been made into at least two movies, and I still have yet to see the movies because I haven't been able to get my hands on them, but I really want to watch one or both of them. It is about a scientist named Chris Kelvin who is sent as part of a team of people to study the planet Solaris. The ocean that covers the entire surface of Solaris is probably a sentient alien being, but humans haven't been able to really communicate with it or figure it out. When Kelvin arrives, the men who arrive prior to him are kind of being haunted by real physical manifestations of people from their memories. And a woman from Kelvin's past appears, and he has to work through his issues with this woman, who isn't the real woman because the real woman is dead, but this person who has appeared is alive, and he can't get rid of her. The point of this book, I think, is supposed to be how can humanity really study and understand other beings if we can't understand ourselves? If we are so kind of fragile mentally and emotionally, how will we ever go out and comprehend the rest of the world? I thought that the idea of the alien ocean was fantastic. The descriptions of the strange formations that it makes, it's just so alien, so good. But I really didn't like Kelvin. Most of the story hinges on his kind of antagonistic, not very healthy relationship with a dead woman, and the way he talks about her, the way he interacts with this doppelganger, I don't think said many good things about him as a person. Probably goes back to just gender dynamics in old science fiction irritates me. It wasn't terrible. I've read far worse. This goes on the growing pile of books that I'm glad I read but didn't necessarily get. I'll be interested to see if I notice any references to this book in other science fiction that I read. I think that's a very common thing that I notice, like when I read an old science fiction book and then I suddenly start noticing all the allusions and callbacks to it from other authors and books and stuff. Solaris is probably one that I will see references to. But at the moment, I'm way more interested in finally watching one of the movies, as I'm very curious about how the ocean and what's going on is going to be portrayed visually, what might or might not be shown. For tea, I read Thick as Thieves by Megan Whalen Turner. This is the new fifth book in the Queen's Thief universe, which begins with The Thief. It has been quite a while since I read the original books, and my memory is hazy on some of the geopolitical stuff going on, so I'll try to recap really quickly if you don't know anything about this series. The central figure of this world is the Queen's Thief, Eugenides. He is the Thief of Edis. He eventually marries the Queen of Atolia. Atolia and Edis have been kind of in conflict, and Eugenides, now as King of Atolia, is setting in motion some clever plans and being his usual cunning self to help defend Edis, Atolia, and I think soonest from the invading Mede Empire. The Medes haven't actually invaded yet, but they are probably going to. Thick as Thieves is kind of a like side note, a side plot, one of those things that Eugenides has set in motion. He sends an Aetolian soldier, who is actually one of the main characters of a previous book, to the Mede Empire to steal the slave of a nobleman who is the brother or cousin of the Mede Emperor. This slave named Kamet basically runs the nobleman's household. At the beginning of the story, his master is killed, probably assassinated by the Mede Emperor, and this means that all of his slaves are probably going to be tortured and killed. So Kamet is motivated to finally run away. He goes off with the Aetolian soldier, and they are crossing a desert, basically trying to get to Atolia. Except Kamet really doesn't want to go. He's trying to shake off this soldier and get away on his own. This was okay. It pains me a little bit to say that it was just okay, because I have loved the previous books and I was so happy to finally see this in print. It finally happened. I am waiting for the real event to actually happen. We've had a couple of books so far that have just been putting all the pieces in motion, getting the board set up, and I am ready for the war to happen now. And yet it hasn't. This is really just the travelogue of a bromance in some way, and I would have enjoyed it more because I like the Aetolian soldier, who's just referred to as the Aetolian throughout it, but I never really warmed up to Kamet. I think what this story was really trying to do is take Kamet's experience as a relatively privileged, trusted, and educated slave and talk about how slavery is still slavery no matter how many advantages a slave has, no matter what concessions they get for their position in a household. And it never really grasped that. It reminded me of Powers by Ursula Le Guin, which is a beautiful and terrible, tragic exploration of what slavery does to somebody. Both of these stories are kind of about when that kind of trust contract between master and slave is broken, except done so much better in Powers, the sense of betrayal when a trusted, respected slave is just finally experiences a tragedy of slavery, what it really means, doesn't really have an impact in this book. The situation is slightly different, but I really couldn't shake the feeling that Turner was going for some commentary on what it is like to be a slave. No matter how gilded the cage is, it's still a cage and there's still abuse. It just doesn't go all the way. It was too slim, it was too brief. Maybe it's because this is kind of a young adult novel, though I don't really see why fundamentally it is young adult, except perhaps in the writing style and the approach. So, you know, it was decent, it was okay, it did not meet my expectations, it did not move the story along enough for my taste, and I really hope there's gonna be a sixth book and I don't have to wait like 6 or 7 years for it to come out. For the letter U, I counted Uncanny Magazine issue 15, which I finished on the first day of May. There were 3 stories from this in particular that I thought were really good. The first one, the best thing in this issue, is the novella called And Then There Were None, or And Then There Were N-1 by Sarah Pinsker. This is a mashup of Agatha Christie and parallel universes where Sarah Pinsker inserts herself in the story. She tells a story about a fictional version of herself being invited to a conference in another universe where all of her doppelgangers have been invited. And then one of them is murdered and to find out who did it. So it's all about these variations of Sarah Pinsker, how her life could have been different, and you know, she ended up with different people or in a different career, and like investigating multiple versions of yourself for a murder of a version of yourself. It was fantastic. I enjoy Agatha Christie, I enjoy the murder mystery plots, and the use of parallel universes was just perfect here. I highly recommend this novella. The other two stories from this that I really enjoyed were With Cardamom, I'll Bind Their Lips by Beth Cato, which is about the binding of ghosts when they return from a war, all the soldiers and people who've been killed who come back to kind of haunt their families for a couple of months before they fade away. It really surpassed my expectations. The other one has a Latin title, which I'm going to completely butcher. I apologize in advance. It's Auspicium Melioris Aevi by YJ Yang. I have really not enjoyed a couple of Yang's previous stories that I've read in various places, so it was really shocking to me that I enjoyed this story right away. It has a rather abrupt ending, and I think that the abruptness of the ending, where it just cuts off, is really good. It says something about the message of the story. It's about clones who are being trained to be as close to their originals as possible. One of them is bad at it and wants to be free to do whatever, and essentially he gets what he wants, then he doesn't know what to do with it. I actually reread parts of the story multiple times because I thought it was really well written. It just grabbed me, but I wasn't sure what it was saying. I still don't know if I completely got it, and I'm curious what other people got out of this story. I want to know other people's opinions on it, if I just had an odd reaction to it, or if other people like it as well. Venus Plus X by Theodore Sturgeon. This is one of the best books from the 1960s about gender dynamics and tensions between the sexes written by a man that I've ever read, which means I haven't read that many of them. But anyway, I was actually shocked at how much I liked this book. I thought it was really good. I don't think I've ever really read an old SF book that is tackling the subject matter head on, very purposefully. The only other things I've read that probably kind of do that are Samuel R. Delaney's science fiction books from the 1960s, but this is very different from that. So the story is that Charlie, a man from the 20th century America, is snatched away to a far future or another universe where these people called the Ladom, or they call their city Ladom, want him to study them, get to know them, and then basically tell them what he thinks about their society. The thing about them is that they don't recognize gender. They are all one gender, kind of like hermaphrodites, so I'm not exactly sure about what their biology is, but they don't really recognize men, women, or those distinctions. They're all one sex. And interspersed with Charlie talking to the Ladom and learning about their society and about their biology and stuff are these flashes to two couples in our world in like the 1960s America. And I think that those snippets are meant to illustrate the gender roles of the time. Both couples are kind of discussing the wife's role, the man's role, the women working outside of the home, men being not exactly the sole breadwinners, and then, you know, men providing childcare as well as their wives doing and everything. I think all of that is just to show you the society, the time, and the attitudes towards gender roles that Charlie is familiar with. But it's this really interesting discussion about gender, how changing biological sex and gender roles changes society. And I'm not sure that it has a really strong message, unlike some other feminist science fiction books or sci-fi books about gender that I have read, but I was just so impressed that Sturgeon never pissed me off. This is an old book, and it still holds up. So I would really recommend this if you are interested in reading feminist science fiction or science fiction that deals with biological sex and gender and everything, men versus women type of thing. This is gotta be one to read. Only two more books to go. For W, I read We Who Are About To by Joanna Russ. This is a short novel, more like novella, about a group of people on a spaceship who crash land on a planet, and they're never going to be rescued. They are never getting off the planet. They are going to die. But most of them decide that they are going to try to survive. They're going to try to have children so that even if they're not rescued, there will be people there when somebody finally shows up. But one woman isn't having any of this. She's like, no, I am not having babies with you. We're going to die. Nobody's going to come and get this, and it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Just resign yourself to the fact that this is the end and try to go out gracefully. So she opts out, and of course they're not having that. The whole group is kind of fighting against her. Like, she's saying, I want to do whatever I want with my body and you can't make me do anything else. And they're saying, oh no, the needs of the group and of the group survival trump what you want for yourself. And it doesn't end well. I really liked this. The first half is probably more interesting than the second because the initial situation is pretty much resolved in the first half. I liked the way the entire thing was written, but I was definitely not as interested in the second bit, which is just a running monologue in her head, basically. Nevertheless, it is a powerful story written in Russ's, I think, usual style that just doesn't pull any punches. She goes there, she says the things, and it's not necessarily beautiful, flowing prose, but it has an impact behind it. I really liked it. I need to read more by Russ. And finally, the last book, Zoo City by Lauren Beukes, which was one of my favorite books that I read in May because it was such a fast-paced read. I pretty much inhaled it in two sittings. This is urban fantasy of a type that I don't think I've really read before. It's set in South Africa, which is the first unusual thing about it that I really liked. And the fantasy element is that sometime in a couple decades prior, people who committed crimes started becoming animaled. You would commit a crime and then an animal would appear and attach itself to you, and sometimes you get a magical power out of this. The main character is a woman named Zinzi, whose animal is a sloth. She kind of lives in the animal ghetto, the zoo city. Zinzi can find lost objects, that's her power, and she has pretty much only one rule, she doesn't find missing people. But she takes a job for an old woman, and then when she shows up at the woman's house, the woman has been brutally, violently murdered, and Zinzi is a suspect. And while she's there, this man and a woman appear and kind of strong arm her into taking a job to find a missing pop star. And Zinzi dives into like the criminal underworld of violence and drugs to try to find this missing teenage pop star. The bit about finding a pop star was just okay. I think where the plot went, especially right near the end, it was a little bit on shaky ground where some explanations were just not given. There's some convenient wrapping up of plot ends in between chapter breaks, so you don't really see how some things happen. But the overall plot was interesting. But what I most liked was just this idea of the animals that, and then the magical powers and how people around the world are viewed in different ways. Different countries have different rules for how they deal with the animaled people. And then that's probably big commentary on other groups that are ostracized and pushed into ghettos and such. And the fact that this takes place in South Africa, which has quite a history with racism and apartheid and those problems, and you kind of see this repeating with the people living in the zoo city. I think that the setting of this is what elevated the book and made it so interesting for me. I read this book at the same time that I was listening to the audiobook of Born a Crime by Trevor Noah, which actually gave me much more context about the history of South Africa and apartheid, how apartheid came about, and then the results of getting rid of it and such. So that those two books together kind of enriched each other for me. So yes, I very much enjoyed Zoo City. I'm not sure if I'll read more by Beukes. I need to know if other people can help me out here, if this book is anything like her other work. I think she writes more in the horror genre, and I'm not interested in reading that, but if she has other works that are similar to Zoo City, I would like to know. Whew. That is everything I read for the A to Z readathon, all 22 books that I read for it in May. I am losing my voice. I need to stop talking now. Thank you guys so much for watching. Once again, if you want to talk to me about any of these books that you've read or that you want to read, please comment down below. And let me know too if you plan on taking part in the next A to Z readathon, which I think Denise has planned for November. I am already excited for it. I'm already planning my TBR for it and trying to find that pesky X book. It's gonna be the real challenge. So yeah. Thank you guys so much for watching and putting up with me for one more video, and I will talk to you again soon. Bye.